We have a very interesting thing to announce now. So the past many years people have been working. The past many years people have been working on different areas, and we have to recognize some people who are standing out, some groups which are standing out, not just people. Okay, so it's essentially not individuals but the group of people. So we have some awards as usual. So the first one is D.D. Kosambi Award for cultivating scientific temper by remodeling the curriculum at the delivery stage. So this essentially what you people have been doing, the students have been doing largely, is being incorporated into the syllabus or how to while delivering the curriculum in the classroom. So some culture of you students have been sort of transferred to the teachers and through them to the larger student body and the education system. So you can see 10 such groups, MHSS Goa, that Sucheta Naik is one of the leading persons there. IAS Jaipur, Srimoyi, Government College, Bilaspur, Komal Singh, Cochin College, Manju and Shrishmita, Bliss Saparkhati, I don't know whether I'm pronouncing it right. This is the first time I'm hearing this place. It's actually on the border of, very close to the border of Burma, okay, in Assam, okay. Sushant Singh, Dyal Singh College, Bliss, okay, Dyal Singh College, Chitralekha, Bliss Silchar, Krishendu Roy. You must be seeing Krishendu Roy's a lot of photos he is organizing on various things. Ganesh Baski and group in Ranchi College, Adarsh Vidyalaya Sridevi, KV Araria Nirmal. The second group of awards, people who are getting the awards, is for in the name of SK Mahajan Awards for Science Education and Research Initiation. SK Mahajan, I don't think we have given an award till now. SK Mahajan has been a very, very interesting veteran scientist in BARC, and he passed away some years ago. His wife, Bhaktavar Mahajan, has been here, a faculty, and she is very, very keen that we should have an award on his name. And we are also, he has been a friend of us, and he has been an inspirer for all these type of work. So in innovations in Hydra culture, Moina. So Arif Lab, who is Arif here? Is Arif here? So we have people say that Obaid's labs, lab, Vidita's lab type of thing, people say that. So this here, there's an Arif Lab, you must have heard about it. And people who are working and joining now, particularly Obaid, Harshada, Deepthi, Ashwini, Sheetal, who just joined recently, and Arif and Sarthak. Now Sarthak has also created some sort of an innovation in Delhi by starting a, it's like, I think you heard what Arif's group has been doing. They have been developing a Hydra into a sort of every home's business, is it not? Now you can keep it in every home, like Jian said about desktop, yeah, type of help, Hydra culture. Something similar, but it has not been really evolved, but there's a seed of that Sarthak has sown, is on Moina. He is developing, he and his groups are developing it into a Parkinsonian model, studying its motility and stuff like that, and which he started actually in Kottayam. There's an inter-university center at Kottayam where he went for his internship, and those people actually has adopted that. Yeah. Dr. Mohan Kumar, who has been known to us from Kolkata, he has also adopted it. So the award goes to that. And the third award is Anil Sadgopal's People Science Awards for Population Science. Now, I think if anybody has been looking at our instant messaging systems, you must be noticing Tushar's group from Konkan has been one of the major contributors to popularizing science, and particularly popularizing science in their area, and particularly very, very extremely brilliant way they have been doing it and very consistent way they have been doing it. One of their contribution, standing a contribution, is slice of every month, slice of the season every month. I think that's a representative sample of the Maharashtra, southern Maharashtra, they have been doing it, which other people are emulating it from other. We have several such slices that's coming from all over the country now. I don't know whether we'll have time to screen all those things. Jay will be doing that. Okay, so that this is what I wanted to announce, and it's a very happy occasion to announce this, particularly in the name of D.D. Kosambi, S.K. Mahajan, and Anil Sadgopal. I think I will stop at that and give the forum to Jay. Thank you very much.
Okay, so one of the major activity in which a lot of people have been contributing in Cube since actually last year is mango mapping. Okay, so this has been, you know, one of the activity in which we have got a large scale, you know, participation from across the country. People have been sending pictures, and so many pictures that, you know, now, you know, we have so much of data within 1 year. Okay, so one of the thing that, you know, what we had started is that to map the mango. So initially what people were sending the pictures of the mango trees, you know, from different, you know, at different time, in every month actually. So what we started to make a hypothesis is that, you know, when do the mango tree flower? So that was the major question. So last year when we did it, we found that, you know, first the mango tree starts flowering in the lower latitude, like, you know, which is, you know, in India it is around near Kerala, for example, Kanyakumari, yeah, because that is, you know, very near to the equator, so it's actually 8 degree north latitude, so it is very near to equator, so it gets a lot of, you know, first it will get the light period, maximum amount of the light, you know. And then the light will be migrating to the upper places. So we have started to see that, you know, when we started to map this, we have got some data here. So this is a map which we had made in January and February. January and February 2017, where you can see that, you know, the yellow ones are the flowers, and the green ones are fruiting. So first thing is you can see that fruiting is first in the is all around near the, you know, southern part of India. So it means that the first flowering happens there. First flower, and then the flowering migrates there, until the flowering will migrate there, the lower one will be started the fruiting. So, and you can see that, you know, as far what we have found that there is a very less amount of flowering in the northern regions. And as we then, if we go to the next month, you know, then February to March, we found that, you know, there is a lot of the flowering which is happening across the India. In the northern part also it shifts. So there is a shift of the the fruiting. Before it was only in the southern part, now it is also started to happen in the the northern part. It means that the early flowering happens there. It begins from there. And then it migrates. So this was the pattern which we observed. And then, So this was the very first. So this is actually the beginning one, September to January. This is, you know, this is what you call around in the winter, actually, when it is, you know, starting winter. Autumn. Yeah, autumn ending, and yeah. So at that time, see, the flowering first begins in the Kerala. So there is no flower. The gray ones are the ones which are not flowering and not even fruiting. So Mumbai is coming there. Flowering doesn't even start there, but it starts in the Kerala. So this was the pattern which we observed. And now this year also, we have repeated the same thing, and we have got the similar kind of pattern. So here is this year's, this is the data of this month, December month. So in December, the flowering is happening there, the southern part. It is coming close to the the Mumbai or Goa, this is Goa in Maharashtra, Ratnagiri side. But in if you go towards this like Bihar, Araria or Assam, that regions are actually not having any flower and not having any fruit.
Which months later?
December of 2017. So this will be around, you know, yeah, so 2 months back. So it means that it has started in the southern part, and so there's a clear cut distinct, you know, what you call the difference which is there. But you can see that two
looks like,
yeah, but there are two things, like, you know, around Karnataka or something, Goa ke baju mein, there is some trees are not even have not started flowering. Okay, so that may be because we have not got some enough data from there. It could be atypical, or it could be, you know, that we have not got enough data. If we look for around for some more data, actually we have less data for that. If we look that, it could also be some of them could be started to flower. But definitely it is not started in the upper part, like, you know, the Bihar, Assam, you know, UP kind of places. So this is a pattern which we have observed. Now what is this actually? Why we are doing this? Okay, first thing is, of course, that, you know, you get a large scale part, the people are becoming sensitive to the you know, environment around them. They are taking pictures. Anybody can do it. Even a, you know, school student can just click a picture and send it to us. You know, we have so many groups. He can, if he doesn't have mobile, he can take a help from parents and all. But the thing is that that is one of the thing. But our question is more than that. What we are understanding is that, you know, we want to look at, you know, there's a why this change is happening. Why actually this is happening? This is because it's called a photoperiodism. The light is affecting the flowering. So tree, there's a tree in Kerala, there's a mango tree in Mumbai, there's a mango tree in, you know, Bihar. But all of these trees could be same, but these trees, you know, are having different behavior. They are flowering at a different period of time. That is only because we are saying that it's a direct environmental effect on the plant. You know, and the environment effect means it's a light effect of the light. So there's a photo period. How much light period will the plant get? It depends on that when it will flower. So it has to go into. If you go into deeper, then it has to deal with the, you know, how there are genes which are responsible for flower. So that means that at that period of time, so once you get that much of light period, that much of accumulation of the, you know, light period, then it will trigger some of the genes. Until that time, it will not be activated. That gene will not be activated. So there are many genes. So you can go up to the level of, you know, how does the flowering, what is the basis for flowering, or what is the, you know, biological, you know, mechanisms responsible for this flowering changes. So this is one of the things. So we have got lot of. I will just show you some of them. yeah. So this is. Okay, so these are some of the things which we have got from, this is from Supriya and Orissa. This is coming from Orissa, Cuttack, and then they have actually, you know, they have been looking at when does the flowering happens. So no flowers or budding leaves observed. This is coming from, so this is Orissa, you know, Cuttack. So no flowering till 15 December. You know, then there is again, new leaves are coming, new sprout of leaves are coming. But there's no mention of flowering. So, okay, there's new leaves are there, but there's no. So again, there's a question that before the flowering happens, the new leaves are sprouting. So why that, you know? Yeah, the our question was that, you know, is it that because their flowering is postponed because there is a leaf which is sprouting. So there is a vegetative growth, but there is no what you call the reproductive, you know, the growth. Is it because there is a sprouting happening because of that vegetative growth, the reproductive growth is getting prolonged? That is one of the questions which we are thinking. So inferences, I think, yeah. Majority of the mango trees of this chosen area of observation sprout new leaves before flowering. So this is the conclusion they are drawing. That before the flowering, the new leaves are sprouting. So whether there is a vegetative versus reproductive kind of, you know, aspect to it. Then, okay, then I will move to other things that we have got lot of data from. As Arunan sir mentioned, that we have got lot of data from Konkan. This is again the slice of the season, that there's a lot of seasons, lot of our biodiversity, or you can say the animals which are there around, whether how the our environment is affecting them, means how what kind of animals we are finding in different seasons. So this is just a collection. I'm not saying that we have not looked at the pattern emerging from it, but we have definitely got a lot of contribution that there are so many butterflies we have got from. So this is a person, Tushar, who has been sending all these entries. So every month, so this was the month of December, then we have, he has also sent in, November, you know, caterpillar. He has all these collections from his around the surrounding and around his school area. So this is a contribution of January, which Arunan sir only talked about. Then I will, this is, I think, again from October month. So, and we have one contributor from Delhi who has actually documented, you know, recorded all the the butterflies in his camp, that is ANDC campus. So he shows some around, there are some 15 species he has recorded, he himself alone, you know. But there is an interesting thing there. So these are around 15 species, you know, I don't know the, names are some, you know, pale grass blue butterfly, Tridex, this is by Subham, so Tridex patch, or there's another one which is Danus. So there are many, so he has actually documented 15, but the interesting thing is not that, you know, you are getting, of course you will get the butterfly, but our question is that what, you know, how many different kind of butterfly you will get it, so how many different kind. We have got one paper, one recent article which says there are around 50 species of butterflies, but that is very less. There cannot be a 50 species of butterfly, we don't expect, because there's so much of, you know, for example, you know, gardens around, you know, so many things, but how, this is in urban areas I'm talking, not the jungle or things, forest-like, but urban areas 50 is documented, which means actually whether the butterfly species are decreasing, numbers of the species are decreasing because of the urbanization, we don't know. Yeah, so this is very, in that way it is a interesting thing to know. Okay, then we shall be, moving to, one more thing. Okay, so this is about the, I just mentioned about the flowering seasons and the different kind of biodiversity around us, but I have another thing which is on the the Drosophila. So you have we have discussed so many things about Drosophila, circadian, students discussed about the circadian rhythm things, and then they also discussed about the evolution aspects in the Drosophila. But we are also looking at, we have just now started I'm just introducing the new system, Drosophila can be used for, as a model system for immunology studies. We have just introduced this. So I'm just, there is a lot of, so Drosophila has actually, you know, Nobel Prize, now recently Nobel Prizes have gone for the immunology studies. So one of the way in which what, so one of the studies by the, these three scientists, so, you know, who have got Nobel Prize is Hoffman, you know, and he has got Nobel Prize in 2011. And the what actually they found out is that you know, how the body senses the pathogen. So initially, so what actually they, so there is a role of innate immunity, you know, there will be macrophages, all these things we know, but what actually what receptors will be detecting that there is a pathogen. So because there are so many pathogens around, okay, there are plenty of different types of pathogens around, so there cannot be a one receptor or kind of thing. So all these things are questions which are there, but they have found out the receptors which are involved in this kind of first, so there's a first line of defense, the receptors they have found, they are called as toll-like receptors. So they're involved in the innate immunity, means so they actually are present. So Hoffman and his colleagues made his pioneering discovery in 1996 when he's investigated fruit flies combating infections. Now this can be easily done in any simple lab, like even cube labs are, you know, it can be done. So they have access to flies with mutations in toll genes, toll-like receptors genes. When Hoffman infected toll mutant flies with bacteria, so they are infecting the flies with the bacteria or a fungi. It means that they are growing them with the bacteria, yeah, in the medium bottle. He discovered that toll mutants infected with fungi died because they could not mount an effective immune response. So which means that if that receptor is blocked or mutated, the organism, the fruit fly, will not be able to detect the pathogen. And if it is not detecting, the whole lot of, you know, immune response will not be triggered. It means that the immune response is coming from that receptors. So they are so important for our whole immune system to know. So that is why it's a huge contribution. So again, the thing was that, you know, okay, it can be used to us. For example, we have this Drosophila, we have this larvae of the Drosophila. Larvae actually, if you just puncture the end of the larvae, the lot of fluid will be coming out. And that fluid is actually the hemolymph. The fluid has the lot of, you know, blood cells. So that blood cells will be having immune cells. So you can get, you know, myeloid, lymphoid, all these erythrocytes, lymphocytes. So we can actually observe them. You know, you can see the blood cells. So if you infect the animal with a bacteria, these bloods, the different kind of immune cells should be getting higher, because the immune response is now triggered. So number of them will be higher. So you can get the higher number means the WBC count will be increased. Like, you know, you can maybe you can get the macrophages level is increased, you know, or B cell level is increased. So all these things are actually, you know, responsible. So those things can be easily assayed in a simple thing. So yeah. Yeah, we can stain. So the thing is that the simplicity is that we can stain with the normal stains. Like, you know, you can use some field differential stain. Field stain are available. Leishman, but field stains are there, which actually stain because there's an acidic. There's a difference in their acidity. Some are acidic, some are basic, so they can be stained easily. So this was the other thing. So I just wanted to So I think just 1 minute I can if I can. Play a video, so then I can just move to the movie session. Oh, I think it will not load. Jane do fir jane. Yeah, we have the videos here, but I'm just one video. You can get 1 minute. Yeah. Done. Yeah, lights, if light was just, I don't know it will work, but I will just check once. If it is not, okay, we can just, we can go to the movie screening session. No, I think it will take time. Yeah, leave it. Okay, so I think it is not going to, okay. Yeah, these are just hemocytes and just moving, random, this is video, but okay. But I will just move to the next movie screening session. So yeah, so everyone has got the small sheet of paper. Has everyone got it? Is anyone there who has not got the paper? Okay, so we will be now showing some movies, and that movies, yeah.
So what is the grade that you have to give, ABC or something?
A grade.
Star. 1 star, 2 star, 3 star.
Yeah. 5 star is maximum. We have the names for the different places. Ka names are there. Okay. Maybe you can write down the names. That is good because. Yeah. 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 But star means, you know, 5 star. If suppose there are 3 movies who are having 3 stars or 3 movies having 5 stars. Okay. Okay, so you can just write down the names accordingly. So I will play in this order only, so no problem. So maybe you can write first is butterflies.
Yeah,
otherwise you can okay, playing, okay. Yeah, just butterflies from Kochi. Okay, if there is any problem in the name, just inform me. Butterflies collection from Kochi. Okay, so this is also again from Butterfly only. So
you can write some remarks also if it is needed.
Yeah, you can write remarks. So now I'm going to next video. This is of something on butterflies, but this is on the pollination of butterflies. How it can be used for pollination. It is coming from Goa. From Suchita's group. Okay, so next, okay, this is actually not a video of, you know, some seasons or something like that, but this is a very important video. You can mark or not, but whether it fits in the criteria of marking, but I'm just saying that it is important because it is a lab, you know. He has made this, the person is called, his name is Nirmal. He has started a lab, cube lab in the Araria, and this is a video of just that. So I don't know. Yeah, I was the one I said. Okay. I don't know. I think it has no volume. But yeah, the one who is watching through microscope is the person. So he has started a lab in Araria. No, it doesn't have any volume. Is it 10? No. No, it has no volume.
Okay, this is mango trees phenology. This is mango flowering. So these are the flowers of mango.
From Begusarai.
From Begusarai. Nirmal, the person's name is Nirmal. My God, I can only see this. This is for me. That was for you, this is for me. So I can only see this.
Yeah, there's a there's one video also as I was playing. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. We'll move to the another group. So,
another group is, this is from Guwahati. This is a Bliss group from, cube group from Guwahati. So I'll just play this. This is about DNA extraction.
This is a group which had also presented the movie maker.
Today we are going to extract.
The DNA extraction he's going to present. They have also sent in the last session, but they have refined some of the things now and they have sent back again.
DNA from banana. The requirements are clear glass and beakers, common salt,
beakers,
banana, glass rod, spatula, needle, distilled water, shampoo, T-net, rubbing alcohol that should be ice cool, and a Ziploc plastic bag. Now, how to do the extraction? First, we have to remove the peel of the banana. After removing the peel, we have to put it inside the Ziploc plastic bag. And then we have to seal it. And now we have to smash the banana. We are doing the smashing because this will break the plant matter. Now we have to take a clear glass and we have to add 2 teaspoons of common salt using this spatula. This is first spoon. This is the second teaspoon. Now, after adding the salt, we have to take the distilled water. Now, we have to pour the distilled water half cup. It's almost the half cup. Now we have to stir the solution very gently. Now the solution we have is the salt solution. Now we will add 2 ml of shampoo that we use in the house. Now that's 2 ml of shampoo. Now we have to stir it well. And we have to make sure that no bubbles should be there. The salt we had added will later help the DNA to stick together. Now we have to add this solution to the Ziploc plastic bag of squished up fruit. We have to add enough so that we have a nice mixture that we can see through it. That's probably about 1/3 of a cup of soap solution. Now flatten out the plastic bag to remove most of the air and then seal it up. Gently squish the liquid around. Let the mixture sit for 10 to 20 minutes to give the detergent time to release a lot of DNA. This is the banana smash after 20 minutes. So the next step is to filter the banana smash. So we will do it with the help of T-neck. We will place the T-neck on a beaker and then we are going to pour this whole banana smash into it. Now we will gently squeeze the banana smash to get a liquid. Now we will place the tea net aside and we will take rubbing alcohol, which is ice cold. So we will add the alcohol as much amount that the liquid is present here. So we will left it for 3 to 4 minutes.
So as you can see, there are two layers. The layer at the upper surface is actually the alcohol in which the DNA is mixed, and the layer which is settled at the bottom is the juice of the banana mash.
Now we have our DNA extracted and it is submerged in the distilled water. So now we are going to add this in our DPA solution. Here we have taken 8 ml of glacial acetic acid with 0.2 ml of H2SO4 and 100 ml of DPS powder. We are adding the DNA here. After it, we will place this test tube in the water bath. It is on 100 degrees Celsius. That means the water is boiling here. So we are going to add this here. We will gently place it. And we will close it. And we will wait for 15 minutes. Now, after 15 minutes, we are going to see what it had happened. It's too hot. Yes, we had DNA. The DPA we had added has turned into blue color, dark blue. So, hence proved that the DNA we had was the DNA. Thank you.
Yeah, last time they didn't have the control, so now they have. They are showing the control also. Okay. Okay, this is again the another one for the same DNA extraction.
Hello everyone, today we are going to extract DNA in a very jugaad way. First, let us introduce ourselves. Hi, I'm Vinita.
Hi, I'm Kea.
And our friend who is shooting the video for us is Sunanda.
The materials which we are using today for our experiment, you can find easily in our home. Before starting our experiment, we'd like to tell you that we took variation in our surfactant, salt and time.
And the variation in the surfactant are Vim, Lifebuoy and Lux. And the variation in the salt which we used are crude salt and common salt. And the variation in this time which we used in the stirring of the solution is, firstly we didn't stir the solution at all. Secondly, we stirred it for 2 minutes and third, we stirred it for 5 minutes.
After conducting a number of experiments with our variations, we got to our standardized protocol which we are going to demonstrate today in front of you. So let's start our experiment. Firstly, let's have a look at the material which we will need today for our experiment. Our source which we are using today, banana. We have some water, salt, a cup, alcohol, bowl, mortar and pestle, almost 10 grams of dish soap. We have taken Vim and a strainer. So our first step will be smashing our banana. As you can see, we have chopped our banana finely so that it will be easy for us to smash it. We'll smash our banana using a pestle and a mortar.
Smashing the banana helps us in breaking apart the clusters of cells from each other.
So we have smashed our banana. As you can see, the banana is properly smashed. So now we'll keep our banana smashed aside and we'll prepare our solution. So for preparing our solution, we'll need a cup, some water. We'll fill our cup almost 3/4 with our water. Now, in the water, we'll add almost 10 grams of Vim. You can use any liquid dish soap. Then, at last, we'll add 1/2 teaspoon. Minutes. So guys, we are back after 10 minutes. So after 10 minutes, we'll filter our mixture using a cup and a strainer. We are using a strainer for filtration. You can use any cloth like muslin cloth or cotton cloth. So now you can see that the debris of the banana smash, which did not get filtered, are left in the strainer and the solution got strained in the cup. So our last step will be, we'll make a layer of alcohol in the solution.
Alcohol helps to precipitate out the DNA out of the
So now you can see that the debris of the banana smash has been left in the strainer and the solution got filtered through the strainer in the Our last step will be, we'll add a layer of alcohol in the solution.
Alcohol helps to precipitate the DNA out of the solution.
And yeah, be careful that you use chilled alcohol for precipitating the DNA. So you can distinguish here the two layers of solution. The down part is the solution of the banana smash and the above part is the alcohol.
the more we let it set, the more DNA gets precipitated out. We can see after 5 or 10 minutes that the DNA which has been precipitated binds together to form a cotony mass.
So you can see that after 5 to 10 minutes, all the DNA which has been precipitated got bind to form the cotony mass substance. Hello everyone, today we are in the second part of our video shoot. In this video, we'll confirm the DNA which we have extracted in our previous video. So let's get started. So let's have a look at the material which we are required for our test. We'll require beaker, test tube, needle for taking out the DNA from the cup, 2 ml of H2SO4, 10 ml of glacial acetic acid, 0.1 gram of DPA which is our reagent, our extracted DNA, and gloves as we are dealing with acids. So let's get started. First we'll take a test tube and we'll add 8 mg of glacial acetic acid. Now in it we'll put 2.5 mg of concentrated H2SO4. Mix it well and then in it we will put 100 mg of our reagent, that is now we'll put our test tube inside it. We need to submerge the whole solution in the water bath. So after 15 minutes you can see that our solution has turned into deep blue, and this confirms that our solution has DNA. So that's all for our experiment. Thanks for watching us. Hope you like it.
Again it was because this is also DNA extraction, so I'm just okay. No, you don't want this. Okay, bad me.
Today I have summoned you along with my classmates.
We don't want that. Okay, first we'll go to then maybe last we'll go to that. Last, yeah, I like it.
Thank you.
Okay. So she actually has done it. Yeah, she actually has done this at her home. So this is her home lab kind of thing which she has made. Yeah. So yeah, we'll move to next. Next is what? Mango market. Okay. Yeah. Okay. This is a first mango which came, and this is a video which person who is from Goa, she has taken from the market. So because the market is a kind of marker for mango, when the mango comes in the market, we can come to know that it may be when the first mango comes to the market, that will be very interesting to find out in various parts of the.
गोवा का आम है 300 रुपए किलो ना मीठा है क्या ये दूसरा टाइप ये कौन सा है बादाम इसका नाम जल्दी है क्या बदलना कितने का और ये कौन सा आम है कितना के जी वो गोवा का है कि बाहर के किन के बाहर किन के थे
हमारे भी ना क्या था
गोड़ा
So you want to hear bargaining? Mango in market. Yeah. Mango phenology next is. This is from Kerala. So this is a place where first the mango flowering starts. So she shows the flowers also here. Yeah, these are the flowers. Oh, mango also, this thing, fruiting. Saw mangoes, no? Yeah, they have actually now started fruiting. This is mango phenology from Goa. So from Sucheta and Sonali and Sucheta.
Thank you.
not so good video, so I'll not much play because. Yeah, this is from Jaipur, so this is again.
Fruit flies can be raised easily wherever fermentation is in progress. In laboratories, they are usually not fed directly with overripe and fermented fruits because the fruit culture media will become too soft by the time new flies begin to hatch due to the process of fermentation. Therefore, fruit flies are fed in more solid culture media enriched with all the nutrients essential for survival and growth of life. Materials required for the preparation of media: conical flask, spatula, cotton, stirrer, measuring cylinder. Standard corn meal media for 250 ml involves various components. Dextrose 12.5 gram acts as a source of carbohydrates. Sucrose 6.25 gram again as a carbohydrate source. Maize powder 20.75 gram enriched in carbohydrate again as a major source, but also includes proteins, fat and some other micronutrients. Yeast extract 3.75 gram acts as a source of vitamins, digested nucleic acids. Agar powder 4.5 gram, it is a solidifying agent for the media. Orthophosphoric acid 0.17 ml and propionic acid 1 ml added to avoid bacterial and fungal growth. All these weight components are transferred into a flask and then total volume is made up to 250 ml by adding distilled water. Then, with the help of a glass stirrer, the ingredients are mixed in the conical flask. Conical flask is then kept on the hot plate for dissolving the media components and stirred continuously. As soon as slight bubbling starts on the top layer, the hot plate is switched off and the flask is removed. We will plug the mouth of the flask with a cotton plug and later it is autoclaved. Fruit flies can be raised easily.
This is okay, we have got only, this is only one video we have got from spiders. So she has been working continuously on spiders and documenting lot of spiders. This is from Kerala, so the person's name is Sri Rekha. And yeah, so spiders are Palu Tree, Kerala. This is a place in Kerala.
She doesn't know names maybe, but
this is just a collection of different spiders. So we can find out whether all of them are spiders or something else also. Yeah, so this is from Delhi. So this is from Think Lab Delhi. And this is about Parkinson's model. Thank you. Okay, so next is again from Jaipur. This is again just the way to transfer the flies.
Why do we need to transfer flies? There are several reasons for this question. Depletion of media, overcrowding of flies, and competition for food. Also, the flies are transferred to make single line culture or to perform any experiment for further studies. Requirements: a culture bottle containing flies, an empty bottle containing only solidified media and no fly, a sponge, and yeast granules. Procedure: 2 to 3 yeast granules are added to new media bottle. As we know, fruit flies are negatively geotropic. Thus, most of the flies are found at bottle's neck. So, a different and somewhat interesting procedure is applied to transfer them. Gently tap the flies down by softly tapping the bottle on soft surface such as sponge to reduce the amplitude of force and to avoid the breakage of bottles. The flies will fall down at the bottom and will remain there for a few seconds. Simultaneously, take off the cotton plug from the bottle and place another bottle containing fresh media in inverted position, such that the mouth of both the bottles join each other. This joining should be covered with a hand. The whole setup is rotated anti-clockwise and tapped on the sponge. This tapping provides jerk due to which flies move in new media bottle. Whole culture consists of different stages of larva and pupa. The culture bottle is placed in upright position. After this, place the cotton plug on both the bottles. New culture bottle is labeled accordingly. Precautions: cotton plug should be tight enough to avoid escape of flies. Culture bottle must be handled carefully. The jerk applied to the flies must be tender. Why do we need to transfer flies? There are several reasons.
This is on trapping of the fruit flies, which actually many cubists are doing.
Let's learn how to trap fruit
flies.
This
is also from Jaipur. So
we'll take a transparent bottle for trapping fruit flies. Bottle should be clean and dry and labeled properly. Here we are mentioning location and dates on a bottle. Now transfer the banana fruit peel in it to attract flies. Clean the mouth of the bottle using cotton. Keep the trap near dustbin or any other area where there are possibilities of trapping fruit flies. Check the trap in proper time interval. As we can see now, flies are there in trap. We'll close the bottle with cap. Make some holes over it to maintain proper aeration. We can transfer these flies in media bottle. Let's learn how to trap fruit flies.
So I think it is done, but only one is remaining. Yeah, it's okay. The Khanpara DNA extraction from Khan. Just little bit of, yeah, they do. Okay.
Today I am Prasanthi Kohli, along with my classmates,
of DNA from tomatoes using the simple method. Materials required for this experiment are tomatoes, plastic bag, salt, detergent, glass of water, muslin cloth, ethyl alcohol, an empty beaker, and glass rods. First, we will take the tomatoes and put it inside the plastic bag. Now, finely crush the tomatoes. After crushing the tomatoes, keep it aside and take 80 ml of water in a beaker or glass and add 2-3 spoons of detergent to it. The detergent will break the cell wall and help the DNA come outside. Now, mix it well with the water. Make sure no bubbles are formed. Now add small quantity of salt and dissolve it into the solution. The salt will help to bind the DNA together. Now add the solution slowly inside the plastic bag. Make sure that the air is removed from the plastic bag. And now mix it. Keep the plastic bag aside in normal room temperature for about 20 minutes. Now we will take the empty beaker and cover the mouth of the beaker with muslin cloth. Filter the pulp present inside the plastic bag to the empty beaker. Add alcohol equal to the level of solution in the beaker after filtration. Make sure that the alcohol is chilled. Now, we will wait for some time till the DNA appears. You can observe some white cottony substance in the solution. This is the isolated DNA of the tomatoes. Now, using a needle, swirl it inside the beaker and take the DNA fibers. We will collect it inside an appendox. So, this is the extracted DNA of tomatoes.
After we take extracted DNA and mix it with DPA reagent and glacial acetic acid, we boil it for 15 minutes in hot water bath.
After 15 minutes of boiling, you can observe that the color has changed into blue, which confirms the presence of DNA. Hope you liked our video.
The way in which they show the how it is different from, see, you can see that how they are doing means they are actually taking some, you know, with things which are available in kitchen.
Yeah.
and they are extracting the DNA and showing. So, but the how it is different from the classroom practical, you know, because we always use these chemicals, you know, like SDS or detergent. So instead of SDS, they are using some another detergent and they are doing. So this is the way in which, you know, they are showing how simple it is to do science. So I think that is what we are able to, you know, from such a brilliant contribution from across the country. So I think Arunan, you will be, you want to say, add something before we close the session? Yeah, yeah. Bye bye. Okay. Yeah. So we have we have collected. So the you have marked this on the paper the movie. So we'll be analyzing using this in order to.
Okay. So I think the type of innovation I think we can claim this time was that we were constrained to have a Bombay meeting for Cube Winter. But then we expanded it to the whole country, and people have been watching even now. I think we were getting feedback from them. Because we have this streaming, that's one thing, which along with that, we have this contribution that's coming from people as a Movie Makers Club. So we have Movie Makers Club all over the country now. And also we had this seasons, slice of season stuff. So both these things gave us enough participation today. So it is no more a Cube Winter Mumbai meeting. It's an All India meeting, though we didn't have to foot the bill for their travel and stay and stuff like that. We had those constraints this time. That's why we could not. But then we transcended that, and thanks to the technology, thanks to these people who were helping us, and thanks to all the participants who were very, very, very much involved in this, and thanks to you people who came here. Now I can see somewhere around 1/5 of the people are here, but I think thanks a lot. So if you, I think please make some comments in the continuously Shreyas type of people, you know. You have been doing the reasonably well, but you have not been contributing regularly, so that you will not get the feedback. You are not getting the feedback. So it's a wonderful thing that we have a huge sort of audience. If you look at the instant messaging system, you will see that people have been watching and appreciating things. Okay. And in fact, there was a correction from Delhi coming saying that one of the movies was what Jay said, that it's from Goa. It's not actually, it's from Dialsin College, Delhi. So they were correcting us while watching this. So it was a wonderful thing that so many people have been involved in that across the country. Okay, thank you very much. So carry on. Okay, thanks a lot for all people who have been from across the country watching and participating in the whole process. Yes? Wave to the camera. Where's the camera? Okay, thanks. Thanks a lot. Yeah.